Hello, welcome to the course SJPHY1 B01 Mechanics 1. The contents of this course is taken from An Introduction to Mechanics by Kleppner and Kolenko. We will continue to discuss topics from Chapter 2, Newton's Laws. In the last class, we discussed about how to apply Newton's Laws into a practical system. Briefly, you need to consider objects as point masses, then draw the force diagram. And based on the force diagram, you can write down the equations of motion and also equations based on Newton's third law. And if the geometry of the problem allows for any specific constraint, you can write down the corresponding constraint equation as well. So once you have a system of equations, you can solve them simultaneously and get all the unknown parameters. So we have also taken a couple of practical systems in the last class and learned how to analyze them using Newton's law. What we are going to do today is we will pick a couple more real life systems, and we are not going to solve them as such. What we are going to do is how to identify constraints in those system and write down the constraint equation. So I have mentioned about the importance of constraint equation in the last class. The thumb rule is that the number of equations should be greater than or equal to the number of unknowns. Only then you can solve it effectively and find a definite answer. So more number of equation, the analysis is going to be easier. Typically, in systems composed of several bodies, the accelerations are often related by constraint. If you recollect the goods train example from last class, the three compartments are connected together. Consequently, the acceleration is same for all the three compartments. So here, the acceleration is constraint. So you can write down the corresponding constraint equation. The equations of constraint can sometimes be found by simple inspection, like the train case, but the most general approach is to start with the coordinate geometry. So let's first consider the example of a wedge and a block. Wedge is like an inclined surface. So a block moves on a wedge, which in turn moves on a horizontal table. The wedge angle is theta. The question is, how are the accelerations of the block and the wedge related? So first, let's locate the position of the wedge as well as the block. So you need a coordinate system, preferably an inertial coordinate system or inertial frame. So if this is the table surface, which is not moving, suppose this is the edge of the table, I am going to make all the measurements with respect to the edge of the table. So this is an inertial coordinate system. Alternatively, if you want, you can measure the position of the block with respect to wedge. But since the wedge itself is moving, probably this is an inertial frame. And as you know, in inertial frame, the analysis is going to be more tedious, because in addition to all the true forces, you also have to encounter the fictitious forces. Okay. So whenever there is an option, always choose an inertial frame. Okay. So this is my origin. So with respect to this origin, the position of the wedge, I call it as capital X, and the X position of the block, it is small x, and Y position of the block, it is small y. And h is the height of the wedge. Okay. Now, what is the constraint here? Which parameter is constrained in this case? As you can make out, the angle of the wedge is constant, right? This is theta. So when the block is sliding through the wedge, throughout the motion, the angle theta is constrained, which means I can write the constraint equation with respect to theta. So let's redraw this diagram once again. So I have the block situated on the wedge, and the height of the wedge is h, and y is the height of the block, which means this remaining height on this side, on the vertical side, is h minus y. Similarly, x is the x distance of the wedge, and small x is the x distance of the block. So this length, this horizontal length, is small x minus capital X. Now from this geometry, you can easily make out that cot theta equal to x minus x divided by h minus y, or x minus x equal to h minus y into cot theta. So you can differentiate it with respect to time twice, which will yield you the constraint equation. So second order derivative of x, d square x by dt square, or x double dot minus capital X double dot equal to derivative of h is 0, because this is a constant, minus y double dot into cot theta. Theta is a constant, so this term is unaffected by the differentiation. So this is the constraint equation written in terms of the constant parameter theta. As you can see, constraint equations are independent of the applied force. There is no force term here. So even if friction between the block and wedge affects their acceleration, the above equation is valid as long as the bodies are in contact. Let's take another example, a mass and pulley system. So I have one pulley and there is a rope passing through the pulley. On either side of the rope, two objects are attached, object 1 and 2. And we need to find how the accelerations of the bodies are related, assuming that there is no horizontal motion. Also, imagine that the pulley as such is moving upward with an acceleration A. First, we need to find out which parameter is constrained here, which is restricted here. So the rope is attached to two objects and the rope is going to move through the pulley. Pulley is accelerated upwards, but throughout the motion, we can notice that the length of the rope is constant, right? So we can write a constraint equation with respect to the length of the rope. Okay. So assume that L is the length of the rope, which is a constant, and YP be the height of the center of the pulley with respect to ground, and capital R be the radius of the pulley. You can also assume that Y1 is the height of object 1 from the ground. Similarly, Y2 is the height of object 2. Now, how do we write the constraint equation? We know that L is a constant, so you can write L equal to, now the total length of the rope equal to this length from this point to here, which is nothing but YP minus Y2, right? Plus this length from this point to this point, which is YP minus Y1. Plus what is the remaining length? Half of this circumference, right? This much. Circumference is 2 pi r, and half of that is pi r. So L equal to pi r plus yp minus y1 plus yp minus y2. Now how do you make it a constraint equation? Constraint equation is usually a differential equation, a second order differential equation. So you differentiate it twice with respect to time. So L is a constant, so its derivative goes to 0. Pi r is a constant, that goes to 0. So on the right hand side, you have 2yp double dot minus y1 double dot minus y2 double dot. And we know that the pulley is moving upward with an acceleration A, which means yp double dot, or d square yp by dt square, is nothing but acceleration A. So the constraint equation becomes A equal to half into y1 double dot plus y2 double dot. So we usually write the constraint equation as a second order differential equation, because your force equation or equation of motion is a second order differential equation. So if you make everything a second order differential equation, it will be easy for you to solve them simultaneously. Moving on to another practical system, a pulley system. You have two pulleys and a rope is going through that. There is an object here attached to the second pulley. So one end of the rope is tied and other end is loose. So when you pull this rope downwards, what happens? This object is going to raise upwards. So the pulley system is used to hoist the block or raise the block as shown in the figure. How does the acceleration of the right end of the rope, the acceleration of your hand, compare with the acceleration of the block? Once again, which is the parameter constraint here? Obviously, length of the rope, right? Throughout the motion, length remains a constant, which means you can write the constraint equation with respect to length. Assume that R is the radius of both the pulleys. Okay. Now you can write length of the rope L equal to first length of this segment, which is X, plus then you have half the perimeter here, which is pi R, plus what is the length of this segment up to here? This is X, and let H be the height of the center of the top pulley. So this much is H. So the remaining portion is X minus H, plus you have another half perimeter, which is pi R, plus this segment. So this total height is X, this is H. So this segment is going to be X minus H. Make it a second order differential equation. You differentiate it twice, left hand side becomes zero. And pi R gets cancelled, H gets cancelled. So you have X double dot equal to minus half small x double dot. What's the physical meaning of it? The block accelerate half as fast as the hand. And the minus sign indicates that both are accelerated in the opposite direction, which is clear from the geometry. As you pull the rope downwards, the block is going to move upwards. So this is how you arrive at the constraint equation. You just follow the geometry closely, identify which is the constraint parameter, write an equation based on the constraint parameter. Now, so far we have been discussing about linear motion, and it's time now to apply Newton's laws into the case of rotational motion. Now, in the case of linear motion, throughout we have been following the Cartesian coordinate system. Now, in the case of rotational motion, you can still apply Cartesian coordinate system, but that's going to be a more tedious task. On the other hand, if you follow what is known as a polar coordinate system, your analysis is going to be much simpler. So this is like the analogy of, suppose you have a wheel, a round wheel, and you want to measure the perimeter, circumference of the wheel. So you have two options. Either you use a rigid meter scale, a straight meter scale, or you can use a flexible meter tape, which you can bend around the wheel. Which one you will choose? Obviously, you will choose the meter rope, right? And what's the reason? Because you can bend it around the wheel, so at once or very easily you can measure the circumference. On the other hand, if you are using the meter scale, you can still measure the circumference, but that's going to be a more tedious task, more time consuming task. The same thing here, you can always analyze rotational motion using a Cartesian coordinate system, but obviously you are choosing a tougher option here. A polar coordinate system are of two types. One is spherical polar coordinates and another one is cylindrical polar coordinates. Now, in the next four or five slides, what I'm going to do is I will give you a brief overview of cylindrical polar coordinates, because without knowing the basics of polar coordinate system, you won't be able to understand rotational motion effectively. So cylindrical polar coordinate system has three coordinates, just like Cartesian coordinate system has x, y, z coordinates. This has r, theta, z coordinate. So here you have a Cartesian coordinate system. Imagine that you have a point at this location and the position vector of that point is r, and the angle with respect to x-axis is theta, then these three parameters r, theta, z constitute a polar coordinate system. Now this is the case of three dimension. What we do is we will take a simpler case of two dimensional motion. For example, an object rotating in a circle, and circle is confined to a two dimensional plane, right? So you can always study circular motion using only x and y coordinates, only two coordinates. So here we are not considering motion along the z direction. So if you switch over to polar coordinates, planar motion you can study using only two coordinates, r and theta. So r and theta are known as plane polar coordinates. Now you can derive the relation between Cartesian coordinates and polar coordinates here. First calculate what is sine theta. Sine theta is going to be opposite side, which is y divided by the hypotenuse, which is r, or y equal to r sine theta. Same way you can write x equal to r cos theta. Now if you take square root of x square plus y square, this is going to be square root of r square, which is r. So this is the relation between r and xy. Same way you can derive the relation between theta and xy. Take y by x, this is going to be tan theta, or theta equal to tan inverse y by x. So which means all the parameter you measure with respect to Cartesian coordinate system, you can easily convert into polar coordinate system, or vice versa. Let's now find out what is the relation between the corresponding unit vectors. So if you plot a Cartesian plane, so you have x and y axis, what do? You draw lines of constant y. So here y is constant throughout. Similarly here y is constant. So all these are constant y lines. Similarly, parallel to the vertical axis, you have constant x lines. So throughout this line, x is constant. Similarly, throughout this line, x is constant. And what do you notice? Notice that the lines of constant x and constant y are straight, and more importantly, they are perpendicular to each other. Same way, you can draw the polar plane. So you have the xy coordinate, and for example, you choose a line along which theta is constant. So this is theta constant, only r varies. Similarly, you can choose another line along which theta is constant, only r varies. Okay, so these are the theta constant line. Now you need to draw a circle along which the radius remains a constant but theta varies. So these are constant r lines, right? Constant r lines. Now you can see that at certain points they both intersect. So if you choose one such point, then you can make out that the lines of constant r and the lines of constant theta both are perpendicular to each other wherever they intersect. Of course, there is a curvature, but if you choose a small section, within that section the curvature is very, very small. So for all practical purpose, you can approximate it to a straight line. So constant x and y lines are perpendicular. Similarly, constant r and theta lines are also perpendicular, which means there is an equivalence between these two. Now it's time to define unit vectors. As you are already aware, the unit vector in Cartesian coordinate system are I and j. The unit vector in the direction of x is known as I cap. Unit vector in the direction of y is j cap, and they both are perpendicular. Now this is the r vector, this is theta. A unit vector in the direction of r is known as r cap, and the unit vector in the direction of theta is theta cap. And just like I and j are perpendicular to each other, r cap and theta cap are also perpendicular to each other. And these unit vectors are known as base vectors. Since these two are perpendicular or orthogonal, they are known as orthogonal base vectors. So the fundamental characteristics of Cartesian coordinate system and polar coordinate system, both are same. Both are primarily made of orthogonal basis vectors. But there is a fundamental difference between the base vectors of Cartesian coordinate system and polar coordinate system. For example, if you choose two points, 1 and 2, characterized by position vectors r1, r2 and angles theta1, theta2. So at this point, you draw both the base vectors. So I have I cap along x direction, j cap along y direction, r1 cap along the direction of r1, and perpendicular to that I have theta1 cap. Same way at this point I have I and j, similarly r2 cap and theta2 cap. What do you notice here? In both the points, the direction of I cap and j cap remain the same. But look at r cap and theta cap. The direction of r1 cap and r2 cap are different. Similarly, the directions of theta1 cap and theta2 cap are also different. So this is the fundamental difference between Cartesian coordinate system and polar coordinate system. The directions of r cap and theta cap vary with position, whereas I cap and j cap have fixed direction. And this fundamental difference between the base vectors become more significant when you deal with derivatives. In the case of Cartesian coordinate system, when you perform differentiation, you do not have to consider the derivatives of I cap and j cap because they are fixed. On the other hand, when you are doing differentiation in polar coordinate system, you need to explicitly calculate the derivatives of r cap and theta cap because they are no more constant. They vary as a function of time or as a function of position. Now it's time now to derive the relation between these two base vectors. Okay, so you choose a point. So its position vector is r, angle is theta. Then you draw all the basis vectors. So I have r cap along the direction of r. Perpendicular to that I have theta cap. Similarly, along the x direction I have I cap, and along the y direction I have j cap. Since all these are unit vectors, their magnitude equal to 1. Okay. Now, since this angle is theta, the angle between r cap and I cap, this is also theta. So calculate sine theta. Sine theta is this side divided by hypotenuse. Hypotenuse 1. So this side is sine theta and this side is cos theta. If this angle is theta, this, as the geometry suggests, is 90 degrees. So this angle is going to be 90 minus theta. Now what is going to be this side? On this side, this is sine theta. So here this is sine 90 minus theta, which is cos theta. Similarly, this side, this is cos theta, this is cos 90 minus theta, which is sine theta. Now you can easily write r cap. R cap is going to be a vector summation of this side plus this side, the horizontal component plus vertical component. What is the horizontal component? Cos theta. So this is cos theta I cap plus, what is the vertical component? Vertical component is sin theta. So sin theta j cap. By convention, we take the right hand direction and the upward directions as positive. So both these components are positive. Similarly, you can write theta cap as a vector summation of this vertical component and this horizontal component. What is horizontal component? Sine theta. But sine theta, this component is towards the left direction, which is the negative direction. So that component is going to be minus I sine theta. What's the vertical component? Cos theta, which is in the upward direction along the plus j direction. So this is plus j cos theta. So this is how you represent r cap and theta cap in terms of I cap and j cap. Now you can quickly cross check whether these relations are correct. Now how do you cross check? You know that r cap and theta cap are perpendicular to each other. And the dot product of any two perpendicular vectors has to be zero. So you cross check whether r dot r cap dot theta cap equal to 0. I hope you know how to calculate dot product. Suppose you have a vector a equal to ar r cap plus a theta theta cap. Similarly, another vector b equal to br r cap plus b theta theta cap. And how do you calculate the dot product? You just take the product of similar components. So this is going to be ar br plus a theta b theta. So you can cross check this as an assignment. Similarly, we know that r cap and theta cap, and they are unit vectors, so their magnitude has to be 1. So you can check this also. So suppose you have a vector a, how do you calculate the magnitude? Magnitude is going to be square root of ar square plus a theta square. So here, how do you calculate the magnitude of r cap? This is square root of cos square theta plus sine square theta, which is 1. Same way you can calculate what is the magnitude of theta cap. Now, in Cartesian coordinate system, any position vector r can be written as a vector summation of the x component and y component, the horizontal component and the vertical component, which is xi cap plus yj cap. But when it comes to polar coordinates, I can write vector r, r is bolded here, which means this is a vector, vector r equal to r into r cap, where r is the magnitude of the position vector. So magnitude multiplied by r cap, which gives the direction, this is your position vector. And we know that r cap is I cos theta plus j sin theta, so I can write xi plus yj equal to r into I cos theta plus j sin theta, from which once again I derive the relation x equal to r cos theta and y equal to r sin theta. And usually when you write any vector in a polar coordinate system, just like in Cartesian coordinate, you write a as ax I cap plus ay j cap, where ax and ay are the components along xy direction. Here you write it as ar and a theta, where these two are components along r and theta direction. So the basic representation and the vector operations like dot product, cross product, they all remain the same. Now the most important question, how do you calculate velocity and acceleration in polar coordinates? Velocity, as we know, is dr by dt, rate of change of position vector. So in Cartesian coordinate system, I can write this as d by dt xi cap plus yj cap. I and j, they are fixed, so you don't have to compute their derivatives. They are constants with respect to this derivative, so this is going to be x dot I cap plus y dot j cap, which is pretty straightforward. Let's calculate velocity in polar coordinates. This is going to be d by dt of r cap. But as I said, r cap and theta cap, they are not fixed. Their direction change, which means they are no more constants with respect to derivative. So I need to apply the product rule. What is the product rule? Derivative of first term into second term plus first term into derivative of second term, right? So this is r dot r cap plus r into dr cap by dt. So I need to calculate this term, dr cap by dt. R cap is I cap cos theta plus j cap sin theta. So dr cap by dt equal to I cap into d cos theta by dt plus j cap into d sin theta by dt. What is d cos theta by dt? You can apply the chain rule. This can be written as d cos theta by d theta into d theta by dt. So your d theta cancel. You have d cos theta by dt. What is derivative of cos theta minus sin theta? What is the derivative of theta with respect to time? Theta dot. Same way, d sin theta by dt equal to cos theta theta dot. So you can substitute for these two terms in this expression. So you have dr cap by dt equal to minus I sin theta theta dot plus j cap cos theta theta dot. theta dot is common, take it outside. So inside the bracket you have minus I cap sine theta plus j cap cos theta. And term inside the bracket is nothing but theta cap. So you get dr cap by dt equal to theta dot theta cap. Same way, you can also calculate what is d theta cap by dt. This is not required for your velocity calculations. Still, just for the sake of completeness, we can derive this as well. So this is the definition of theta cap we have derived. So d theta cap by dt is going to be minus I d sine theta by dt plus j d cos theta by dt. So you expand this, this is minus I cap cos theta theta cap minus j cap sine theta theta cap. And minus theta dot is common, take it outside. So we have minus I cap cos theta plus j cap sine theta into theta dot, and the term inside the bracket is nothing but r cap. So this is going to be d theta cap by dt equal to minus theta dot r cap. So once you compute these two, you can put it back into the velocity equation. So v equal to d by dt into r r cap, which is r dot r cap plus r into dr cap by dt. Substitute for dr cap by dt, you get v equal to r dot r cap plus r theta dot theta cap. Now, in general, in polar coordinate system, I can write vector v as vr r cap plus v theta theta cap, where vr is the r component and v theta is the theta component. So imagine the case that the angle is constant. Suppose a particle is moving along this direction, along the direction of the position vector, where theta is constant. So in this expression, theta dot is going to be zero. So your velocity is going to be r dot r cap. So vr, the r component of velocity, is nothing but r dot. This is known as the radial velocity. On the other hand, imagine that the body is moving along a circle, and for a circle radius is constant. So when you calculate velocity, r dot dr by dt, this is going to be zero. So velocity has only the theta component, r theta dot theta cap. So v theta is nothing but r theta dot. This is known as tangential velocity. So in rotational motion, velocity has two components: radial velocity, which is the measure of the linear motion, and tangential velocity, which is the measure of circular motion. Since velocity has two components, it is common sense that the acceleration is also going to have two components. Okay. So how do we calculate the acceleration in polar coordinates? Acceleration a equal to dv by dt. We know the expression for v, so substitute for that, this is going to be d by dt of r dot r cap plus r theta dot theta cap. Use the product rule and expand this. R double dot r cap plus r dot dr cap by dt plus r dot theta cap plus r theta double dot theta cap plus r theta dot d theta cap by dt. So basically you will have to apply product rule twice in the case of this second component. Now substitute for dr cap by dt and d theta cap by dt. You get acceleration a equal to r double dot minus r theta dot square r cap plus r theta double dot plus 2 r dot theta cap. So you have one r component, which you can call as ar, and one theta component, which you can call as a theta. So one will represent the linear motion and one will represent the circular motion. So this is the basics of polar coordinate system. And the next class, what we are going to do is we will take a couple of real life examples from rotational motion, and we will see how to analyze them using polar coordinate system. That's for today. Thank you.